Hey guys, welcome to Models Talk. My name is Katharina.
And I'm Candace.
And today we are going to talk to the winner of the very first model search for VIVA GLAM Magazine, Anna Katharina.
Oh, and talk about beauty and brains. This is somebody who went from super nerd to supermodel. So I'm so excited. Let's talk to Anna.
Yes.
Anna, you were the winner of our very first VIVA GLAM model search. And we were so excited to have you. And you were actually a student at that time.
Correct, yeah.
But since then, you have seriously blown up and your modeling career is amazing. So tell us all about it.
Yeah, you guys were actually my very first photo shoot.
No, I didn't know that. That's awesome.
And I was so nervous because you guys were just so professional and amazing. And I felt like I was joining a group of women that was good at everything. So that was a little intimidating.
Are you kidding?
Yeah.
I can't believe it. Okay.
No, it was so intimidating, but you guys were wonderful. I mean, you guys are amazing. But my very first photo shoot, mm-hmm. and then having to go back to school was such a bizarre transition. Mm-hmm. And I felt like I had to, first of all, I had to finish my degree.
Right.
And then I could, you know, pursue modeling full-heartedly because it's bizarre having to mix the two. I feel like people don't take you quite as seriously when you're in school as well as a swimsuit model. You kind of have to pick one or the other. I mean, you don't necessarily have to, but I felt more comfortable finishing my degree and then pursuing modeling afterwards.
Right, well, that makes sense. Mm-hmm. And you know, we talked a lot when we, well, why don't you talk about first, where did we go for your shoot?
We went to Cancun.
I know.
That was amazing.
So exciting.
Just like this gorgeous resort. We had amazing food, amazing beaches. Mm-hmm. The crew was phenomenal. The photographer was amazing. We got beautiful shots. The styling, makeup, everything was just like a dream.
It was so cool. And we also had a lot of time that you and I in specific got to really talk and bond. Mm-hmm. And I remember, I'll never forget. Now, this is a time, mind you, when you're wearing snakeskin pants. I remember. And I was like, tell me where you get those snakeskin pants. And you were like attracting guys left and right. I totally remember that because you come across as this beautiful model who had not, this was your first job, I had no mm-hmm. idea. You just had this confidence and this air mm-hmm. about you. But when you were doing that, you were saying that you were nervous on the inside because you had never modeled before. Oh, and I remember you telling me, this is so interesting, we're eating, you said, I feel like a nerd. And I go, what do you mean? And you said, I'm a nerd on the inside. Because you said before, you would just go to school, have your no makeup hair pulled back in your glasses.
Absolutely.
So explain that dichotomy to me. I mean, was it challenging to you? Because you said inside your head, mm-hmm. I remember you saying this to me, inside my head, I'm still the nerd.
I want to remind you that we were walking through the airport with a bunch of beautiful women. That was not just me. Are you kidding me? Like combination of you and Katharina, all of us was probably giving people heart attacks. So that was not just me. I would just like to remind that. But yeah, the inner nerd. I mean, all through middle school, high school, I had to get the best grades. I hung out with the teachers. I was a total geek. I mean, I loved everything from like zombies, dinosaurs. Like I was like an inner like little boy mm-hmm. on the inside. You know what I mean? And so then to be considered like a glamour model or a swimsuit model felt so out of body. And I think that that's been my biggest issue transitioning into full-time modeling now. I am not, even though you get that attention every single day, it doesn't feel right. You know, it isn't like quite soaked in, if that makes sense. I feel like I'm still the 12-year-old me.
Right, I remember you telling me that.
Yeah.
And I remember, it's like Sally Field when she got the Academy Award and she was saying, you know, I feel like an imposter because the person on the inside is not the person that everybody sees.
Like, how did I get away with this? Like, how did I even get here? It makes no sense, you know, but I don't feel like I quite fit in. But maybe that is why this journey has been so interesting. I feel like I haven't quite fit into the mold of being a glamour swimsuit model, and I think that's kept me out of certain situations and also given me some perspective in the modeling industry because it's really, it's hard.
What type of perspective?
I think that as a whole, society kind of feeds off of, they rely on us being insecure. The industry would collapse if we felt like we were good enough on our own, you know, whether that be beauty, fashion, you know, diets, things like that. If we felt like we were good enough on our own, there'd be no money to be made. And that perspective has really helped me, you know. I mean, I've considered quitting modeling 10 times since January.
Oh, seriously? I didn't even know that.
It's just been like a back and forth thing where I'm like, I need to do this 100%, but it also does not fulfill me the way that, you know, I think, I don't want to say it's not a career, but something, you know, I want to use my degrees. I want to.
And your degree is in?
Graphic design.
Right.
Correct. Correct. And I think that that would be maybe a little bit more fulfilling option for me, just because it, I feel like, you know, no matter how hard you work in the gym, no matter how many procedures you get, how much weight you lose, mm-hmm. not everyone is going to consider you perfect, nor are they going to book you that job. So mm-hmm. it's been difficult.
And do you feel like that's been the biggest struggle? And do you feel like you struggle with your own perception of the way you look versus the way others see you?
Oh, absolutely. And I think that modeling is, unfortunately, one of those careers that it crosses over into your personal life, like most careers do. But it also affects the way you see yourself, your self-esteem, what you see when you look into, you know, into the mirror.
Into the mirror, yeah.
Exactly. It's like, you know, I can work my butt off in a career and I can see the payoff. Mm-hmm. But I can do the same amount of effort when it comes to my looks, and then I can still not book that job.
Exactly. And then what do you do?
And then you just feel like, am I not beautiful enough? Am I not thin enough? You feel like there's just this constant battle with yourself. Mm-hmm. You know, and I think I don't want to get too emotional about that, but I see a lot of women, you know, become so self-deprecating, so insecure, you know, afraid to look, you know, overly confident or cocky because they don't want people to say, oh, they're just, you know, an overly confident model. You know, I don't want to look like that on social media.
Well, then also that, you know, that brings an interesting question too, because I remember when you and I were traveling, you were saying, you know, you guys are so nice, and I'm not used to women being nice to me.
Absolutely.
Because I think, because of the way you look, that sometimes you're an affront to other women. Do you feel like you're an affront to other women and have to make an extra effort so women will go out of their way to like you? Does that make sense?
Absolutely. I had a very unfortunate thing actually at Pavilions the other day.
Oh, no.
There was a woman ahead of me in line, and she was having a really nice banter with the cashier. And they were laughing, and I felt like I was kind of eavesdropping, and I thought that they both were hilarious, and they were very witty. And I went up, and I felt like I kind of continued the joke, and the cashier immediately shut down, wanted nothing to do with me, was borderline mm-hmm. mean.
Mm-hmm.
And I felt like I kept sucking up to her ultimately. To, you know, kind of, I wanted the same banter that this other woman was able to get, but because I don't know if I'm, you know, I'm a giant or I'm blonde or I have, you know, implants, I don't know what it is truly, but she did not want to be nice to me. And I feel like I get that, I receive that effect often.
That's what you were telling me, because
yeah.
you were actually surprised that we were just, you know, being friendly and normal, which is mm-hmm. normal for us. But I think, I wonder, you don't get that often because women are either intimidated by you, don't know what to think mm-hmm. of you, or because, you know, from the outside, I think you look like a gorgeous supermodel, a Viva Glam yeah. gorgeous supermodel. And on the conversely, I think it's interesting because you were telling me with guys, and I saw it myself when we were in Cancun. Remember we were sitting there at that restaurant, we were eating that Japanese food, and
yeah.
yes, and some stranger came up to us and said, excuse me, the gentleman over there would like to be introduced to you. And we're like, that's so freaking weird. And
yeah.
it was happening all the time. Mm-hmm. And then you told me recently you were somewhere doing a shoot mm-hmm. and some guy drove by. And talk about total cliche for LA was mm-hmm. like, my name is so-and-so, check out my IMDb. And you're like, oh my God, so gross.
Yeah.
But I mean, the same thing where you have all these men, it's almost like they're stereotyping you.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, do you feel like that's a challenge because they're not taking you seriously when you are a sharp and really interesting person?
I think that I have reached a point with that I've accepted, I'm kind of playing up that stereotype. And mm-hmm. I think that you should be allowed to have the extensions and the blonde hair and the boobs and the lips and the, you know, the tan, all of that. I think you should be able to have that without worrying about men, you know, chasing you and accosting you basically when you're
yeah.
with your friends. But I think that you have to reach a level of maturity that you know you're playing into that, and you have to accept that that's your reaction that you're going to receive. It does not mean that you're asking for it, but you also have to realize that that's the reality of the situation. You know, I see all women getting that reaction. You know, it's not just me. I think men just can't help themselves. I don't know.
No, it's true.
Yeah, they're like, I might as well shoot my shot. You know, might as well. I think
it's almost like poor men, you feel sorry for them because they just can't, in their own way, can't help it. And I saw that with you. It's like right and left and right and left that was happening.
Mm-hmm.
And you just must just get used to it, I guess. But that inner nerd inside of you
mm-hmm.
is probably like, oh my gosh, like what is seriously going on?
What's so funny about that is I feel like I, you know, during that part of my life when I was in school and that was my first shoot, I felt like that I got more attention during that time than when I do now living in LA as a model. I don't
mm-hmm.
know what that is. I think that maybe it's just where we were, the situation, but I feel like men are more frightened to approach now.
Because they're like more intimidated or something.
Who knows what that is? I have no idea.
And you know, we're talking about beauty and feeling insecure about our beauty, and our greatest challenges are sometimes within ourselves.
Correct.
And I remember you just talked about implants, and that's the only reason I'm bringing it up, mm-hmm. is when we were in Cancun, we were talking, you were like, I want to do this, I want to do that. And I'm like, no, I think you're beautiful just mm-hmm. the way you are. But yet you chose to get implants, which I think is awesome and fine. Mm-hmm. But it's like, is that a decision for yourself? Is that a decision for modeling that's going to help for a bikini model's career? Or something that you wanted long-term for yourself to help your own vision of who you want to be?
I think there's so many aspects to that question. I think that women in general feel very comfortable sharing a list of things that they would like to change about themselves. Mm-hmm. I think that if I were to ask you, you know, what's your favorite thing about yourself, you would feel much more comfortable sharing with me the things that you would want to change out of just even, you know, out of being approachable to women. I mean, women relate to that. Like, oh, no one's perfect. No one feels perfect. It immediately makes women feel like they can open up to you. And I think that that was a big switch in my mind, was when I heard that with another person. I went, oh my gosh, there, you know, was another model. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh my gosh, I mean, I'm the same way. I want to change all these things about myself. She's just like me. And when I started modeling, and I mean, even before that, I think there was just something in the back of my head where I thought that, you know, getting my breasts done would make me feel more womanly and make me look more feminine. And in reality, I don't think it helped me modeling wise at all. I think that it kind of put me into a category that was maybe the opposite of what I wanted, you know, whether that be lingerie or, you know, just sexier.
Well, because that's what I mean. It's like, do you want to ultimately do, you know, just for modeling, do you want to be a bikini lingerie model, or do you want to do, because you have the height too, you mm-hmm. want to do the high fashion modeling, and then as you get older, like, you know, do you want to segue into a different type of modeling? Because having breasts does make you sexier.
Absolutely.
You have a sexy body anyways, you were sexy before.
Thank you.
You know what I mean? But it does put you in this certain category.
Oh, of course. I mean, I've just totally rambled.
That's okay. I'm sorry. That's totally cool.
I have like sweat dripping down my back right now.
I have sweat on my back right now. And I have sweat right here, so let's just get rid of it now.
Okay, there. Sorry. I think that as my modeling career has progressed, I've realized that I would like to take more of a sports casting, broadcasting route.
Oh, that's awesome.
Other than lingerie, because I have a very hard time just standing still in front of the camera. You know, that's something I can do a couple days a week, but I think that being who you are and showing your personality has the longevity that I am hoping to have in this career.
Right, because you're so well-spoken.
Thank you.
Yeah, you just got such an amazing, bubbly, sharp career, and you have so much more going on with you than I think what people see, what naturally may meet the eye. And do you feel that that's been a challenge for you, that when people see you immediately, they may think one thing, and I mean, even as far as to go, say, you know, like a blonde bimbo stereotype, mm-hmm. And then when they actually see who you are as a person, there's this huge dichotomy between the two. Mm-hmm. I mean, do you feel like it's been challenging in your personal life and also as a model to be taken seriously?
Absolutely, very hard. Mm-hmm. But I also think there's a benefit just with the shock factor. I mean, what's better than that? I think that we need to start thinking of it as a positive thing. You know, you walk into a room, people expect the worst, you know, just personality-wise, relatability, friendship, anything like that.
Right.
They're going to expect the worst. And then you open your mouth and they realize that you're actually a kind person, you have some depth. I think that that shock is so much more exciting than looking, I guess, the way that you are. I think that having that the double side to that is a positive.
Right, that you surprise them. Mm-hmm. I mean, so many times when I walk in a door, I mean, seriously, I think people don't think I speak English. And so, you know, like it's a surprise to them.
Absolutely.
That I don't have an accent.
Mm-hmm.
And people will say, you have no accent at all. How long have you been here?
Mm-hmm.
What do you mean, how long have I been here? I've been here for 5 generations.
Yeah.
I mean, you know what I mean? Like, people don't understand that. It's so
they can't wrap their head around
it. And so I think, okay, if I was walking around an honest body, you know, what would I see as these misconceptions of who I am? Because mm-hmm. I see you as this really bright, super funny, great to be around person, you know, but I wonder how women are perceiving you. And like you said, sometimes in a not good way.
Mm-hmm.
And then men perceiving you as a sexual stereotype.
Absolutely.
And as somebody to be objectified.
Oh, I've always attracted the worst kind of men. I just now got it right.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah, I feel like I just now got it right.
How do you keep your personal and your private life? Because they're just talking gossip about you in Us Magazine. You know, how do you keep that away from your friends, your family, you know, your own life that you have that's your own private, precious life?
Absolutely. I think when you're in your 20s, you're bound to go on two dates or, you know, date a man for a month and then it doesn't work out. You just aren't, you weren't compatible.
Right.
Unfortunately, with social media and, you know, just certain magazines, they're going to capture that point in your life and then judge you for moving on so quickly, when in reality, that's what every single person is doing. I was just shocked to find out that people even cared. I didn't know why people would possibly, why they would care, because my friends were going on dates and in seeing men for 4 or 5 months, and then they were single for a year and then be dating someone new. Mm-hmm. And I was like, that's completely normal in my opinion. But because I had an article written about it, it somehow received, you know, much more judgment than I signed up for.
Well, was it challenge and difficult when you were still in school, and yet all this, because I think you were dating, is it The Bachelor? Or, yeah, and mm-hmm. then all that was going on, because I remember seeing it in the media, and I did some research and I saw all these past mm-hmm. articles. So you're in school, and yet your name is out all over that mm-hmm. you were dating this guy, and you're saying they wanted you guys to win, and then you broke up, and said, I mean, just this mm-hmm. you know, this huge amount of PR and publicity, and you're in school with no makeup on and your glasses studying away.
I'm mean, 22. What did, yeah, I'm a 22-year-old nerd, and people don't see me like that. They see me in sweatpants and oversized
yes!
T-shirts, and then I have all of a sudden my teachers coming to me on Monday saying that they read this article, and it was overwhelming to me. I could not maintain that relationship strictly. It was just too much for me. And I've learned to not share my relationships since that point. Mm-hmm. There was about 3 years where I kept everything hidden. I just did not, I would say more like two years where I kept things hidden. And the relationship I'm in now, we were stable enough that I felt like I could put that on social media.
Which I've seen, yeah.
And I'm confident in that, because there's always this fear of putting yourself out there and then women or men wanting to ruin that and sending you messages
yes.
and saying, oh, I heard that so-and-so is with so-and-so, and you're just, you know, your world's crashing down on you and you don't feel confident in your partner. And I felt like the man that I am dating now, I could take that. I trust him, you know, completely. And so I felt comfortable putting him out there on my social media. And I knew that he is also secure in himself, that he could receive, you know, any sort of message or comment about me and feel good about what we have. Because we have a relationship, you know, that's so goofy and so real. It's not necessarily what it looks like on social media. So I think that's the beauty of it.
And it is such a, because you are so goofy. I think that people don't understand that you're as goofy as you
yeah,
are.
Yeah, they're a little thrown off.
So anyways, we had such a
yeah.
wonderful time. Thank you so much
so
for coming on today. It was so good to mm-hmm. see you. I'm so happy for you.
And thank you so much.
I'm so excited that, you know, I take pride that Viva Glam Magazine was kind of like you're kicking off to this incredible career that
100%.
You're having right now.
Absolutely.
Cool.
It wouldn't have happened without you guys.
Oh,
I didn't
so
even
excited.
Know how to use social media before you. My first Instagram posts were in Cancun.
Are you
Ultimately,
kidding?
You know, I had maybe 4 or 5 posts before that.
Oh,
I mean, this
gosh.
All started because of you and Katharina, which is incredible to me, and I'm so thankful for that.
Oh, it makes us so
mm-hmm.
happy. Awesome.
Yeah, it was amazing.
On the next episode of Models Talk, I sit down with Desi Mitchison, who made it to the top 15 of the Sports Illustrated swimsuit contest. Desi tells me how she's overcoming her struggles as a petite model.